praise God. So I brought a shofar. So this is from Jerusalem. This is something I keep. So when I go into countries, I like to blow it, scare a lot of people with it, entertain people, whatever. But there's power in the trumpet of the Lord. So I believe when it talks about the trumpet will blow and the dead of Christ will rise, I believe this is what it's going to look like. I believe this is the trumpet of the Lord. So we'll just kind of wake up this community, shall we? Oh, I get a headache every time I do that. Just me, head brush. Okay, wow, that's clear.
I like that.
Yeah.
I like it.
That was only like 10 US dollars, so it'd be 500 pesos. It's not bad. It's not bad. They've got really nice ones in Jerusalem that are longer. It's from a ram sword, so it's from an animal. But I got the cheapest because I just don't like to spend money on stuff, you know, because then it's more stuff I got to put up with. So I keep my life very simple, and I think that's part of why I'm attracted to you people, because you keep life simple too, and we have a lot in common. I don't feel like I have a lot in common with mega churches and their fog lights and their smoke screens and all their fancy everything. Because Jesus said, don't store up your treasures on earth.
Amen.
That's what he said. He said, don't do it. Don't store your treasures on earth. Store it in heaven. So when Jesus tells us not to do something, and he's kind of the founder and the leader of Christianity, we should listen to the words of Jesus.
That's right, amen.
It's okay to have stuff long as stuff doesn't have you. Okay? So I wrote a book. I worked on it 3 years. It's huge. It was something God told me to do. I like writing on Facebook, but that's easy. Sometimes it takes me 20 minutes to make a good post because I'm really thinking about what I want to say because I'm a leader, and leaders influence people.
That's right.
So yes, I'll spend some time thinking about what I want to say just for a Facebook post. Why? Because I want to impact people. You know? I don't just throw something out there. I was taught in Bible school, do everything you do on purpose. Do it on purpose. And I'm not talking about purpose-driven life like Rick Warren. He's doing a lot of goofy things on purpose, and he's a false prophet. So his purpose-driven life is going to drive people to hell. Amen? I mean, anybody that would pray over President Obama, I mean, you know, we're supposed to pray for our presidents, but like when you think you got something in common with them, you got issues. Like, I don't have anything in common with Obama, except we both breathe God's air. You know? So I worked on this 3 years, and after I left the Philippines, later on I was in Thailand. And you people inspired me so much that I put your picture of you preaching in the rain on a t-shirt. Yeah, but I ended up putting it in my book too. Now I've been to 50 countries now, but at the point of this book it was 45. So you're talking lots of photos, but you guys made the book. You made the cut. You know, I traveled with one guy from Poland to 4 countries and I forgot to put him in the book, but I didn't forget you guys. So it shows the brave hearts right there under Asia. Amen. And that's me at the Great Wall of China. And this is a cute story. I met this guy in Finland. I was getting off of a Russian cruise, and he was Chinese, and he wanted to talk to me. Well, I didn't have any money to get to where I was going to stay, and I have at least $3, you know, that would be, how many pesos? I usually have 200 pesos on me, but that day I didn't have any money. So God humbled me and made me ask a complete stranger for a €3 to get to my place that I had already paid for. So I asked this guy, hey, I feel horrible, but can you help me? I'll pay you back later. You can have my money from other countries I just left. Just please help me. I'm so embarrassed. We became friends. And I shared the gospel with him. His name is Jack. And he said, my sister is getting married in China. I said, well, what month? He said, June. And I did already tell y'all this story. I did, didn't I? So then I went to his sister's wedding in China. I went. But I met him in Finland. Amen. So God did that. And I wore my Trust Jesus t-shirt. And I wore it because when you wear a Christian t-shirt and somebody wants a photo with you, they just showed all of Facebook your t-shirt. So I'm the type of person when I go in a country, I will tell people, put that camera on me. I'm not an egomaniac. You know, maybe sometimes I am, you know. But I want the camera on me so I can give a message.
Amen.
I want you to take my photo because I want to show the message. So when I met the people in China, they probably put it on Facebook or Instagram. I preached in Iceland in October. And this really, really popular guy that was a model started writing me in my inbox. And I had a feeling anything that I wrote him back, he was going to use against me. But see, I had the upper hand because I knew what I was doing. I already was aware that the enemy was going to try to start a fight with me. So this really popular guy writes me from Iceland. We had caused a big stir in Iceland, me and Simon. The Holy Spirit used us in Iceland, and by the end of the week, we had made like 8 different broadcasts, and they contacted me and said, can we do you on the news as well? And I said, well, Simon's new to the ministry. I'm going to let him go do it because he needs to know how to do interviews. You know, I don't need to do the interview. You go do it. Simon ended up doing the interview, and the guy on the radio that wasn't saved asked him to pray for Iceland on the radio. Praise God. All because we showed up at a high school and preached. And then all that happened. See, the little boy brought Jesus the loaves and the fishes. And Jesus took it and made it bigger. And that's what we're doing with preaching. We're bringing the bread of life, the living water. And if God wants to make something go viral, he can. And in that place, God sent me to Iceland because I found out that it was 100% atheist, ages 25 and under. And when I got to the airport, here comes this redhead, young, brave heart like yourself with his backpack. Simon shows up. What are you doing, Simon? I'm moving to Iceland with you. I'm just going for a week, but the guy moved there. He didn't just move there. It was the winter, which meant it was freezing cold. But he didn't care. He wanted to be a missionary. He wanted to make his life count.
Amen.
Praise God. So he goes over there. The Holy Spirit uses us to stir everything up. Believe me, it was amazing. And then I leave and go back to America like, hey, it was just another day in the office. But they just kept writing me, and they were writing him, and he stayed for almost 3 months. Now he's in Bulgaria. So what happened was somebody really popular started writing me. A lot of the kids did. But the popular kid wrote me, and he started asking me questions. So I purposely, remember, leaders do everything on purpose. I purposely started answering him with Bible. Bible answers. Instead of just trying to get rid of him or saying something, you know, seeker sensitive, I was nailing him with the word. Well, I'm glad you asked. Here's what God says about homosexuality. So he took a snapshot of our whole conversation, stuck it on Instagram, wrote me back and said, ha, 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 now thousands of people are going to read this. I'm like, good, because that's why I did it. I'm not stupid. See, the Holy Spirit wants to reach lost souls.
Amen.
So he's going to set us up on purpose so the gospel can get out. See, a stage is made to let your light shine. I've seen lighthouses all over the world, and the purpose of lighthouses is to shine for those in darkness. So when they're coming on the boat, even if the boat's rocking, whoa, I feel like I'm gonna puke. Even if the boat's rocking, you got your eye on that lighthouse. This is the 500 year Reformation year of when Martin Luther had 95 things he found wrong with the Catholic Church and took it, the 95 theses, and nailed it to the church in Wittenberg, Germany. I've been to that church. And beside that church is a tower that you can walk up spiral steps in, get to the top, and overlook the city. Well, in German letters around the top, it says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. We got to run to that righteous tower, amen. And we are safe. Because there's going to be times you do something for God, and you're like, I can't believe I did that. I'm probably about to get killed.
Yeah.
But you run to that. You run under the banner of the name of the Lord. Because you're going to be safe. Yeah. Okay. Matthew 5. Matthew 5:14. Now, this is the words of Jesus. You are the light of the world. Wow, put that on a bumper sticker. That's a lot of pressure. Because some of us don't want to shine. We want to blend in. That's why I tell the Christians, you need to come out of the closet, because the homosexuals came out of the closet. We need to come out and let our light shine.
Amen.
You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. That's why a lot of street preachers will get soapboxes. Because it's a psychological thing. When you get on a soapbox, you are saying, listen up, people, I got something to say. And it automatically makes people go, who does this person think they are, being on that stage, being on that soapbox? I think it's psychological. And it's just like a lighthouse. It is up there and it's shining, but it's doing its job. That's our job. Our job is to shine.
Amen.
John 1. Okay, let's go verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Now put your name in there. There's a man from God. There was a man sent from God. His name was Michael.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Are you sent from God or not? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes, we are being sent by God. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the Lord that all men through him might believe. He was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of the light. There was the true light, and it's not the lights in the church, the fog lights and all those kind of lights. Now those lights, the church has a new word now. It's called eye candy. Candy. You know how we give children candy at Easter through the Easter bunny? That's what the American church does. Here, come get your candy. Well, now the church is giving eye candy to the American church and other churches because it's attractive seeing the sparkly lights. So churches are getting full because of the eye candy. Doesn't mean they're saved. You know, sometimes churches get discouraged because it's not full. And I'm like, Jesus had 12 disciples. Yeah. He didn't have a mega church with fog lights.
That's right.
You know, when the disciples were persecuted, people said about them, we know that they've been with the Lord. Some churches, I don't want to have anybody know I was there. It's nothing to be proud of that you went to a humongous mega church if they're compromising. Now, if they're doing a lot for the Lord, it's cool. You know? You could be a mega church and change the world. It's not all bad. But the ones that are compromising, yeah, it's not bad. Sometimes churches need to close to the glory of God. You know what the Chinese church said about America? The Americans can do church without God. Yeah, because you can build it on fog lights and candy to your evangelism. I went over to Hillsong Church. Are you listening? I went to Hillsong Church in Sydney. I was going to try to go to Hillsong and enjoy it because I like a few of their songs. But then I saw on Facebook that they were going to have Santa Claus, at their church. In their pulpit, on a stage, like he's the light of the world. No, he's false prophet. Santa Claus, false prophet. Anything that points you away from Jesus is a false prophet.
Yeah.
Even if they point you to Mary. Come on now.
That's right.
The Pope told everybody on Twitter this year to seek Mary. That was his tweet. Mary's going to help us in 2017. Come on now. No, she's not.
And
she's not the queen of heaven. But they'll fight for that right that she is. See? But I went over there and I confronted that church all by myself. Holy Spirit gave me the words and I preached. And the security at Hillsong Sydney told me I couldn't be there. He even lied to me. The police were coming. Well, guess what? An hour later, I'm still tearing it up. And the cops aren't there. So he even lied. But I asked somebody working for that church, I said, hey, did you tell the children the truth about Santa Claus? They said, no, they'll find out later. I'm like, what a jerk. You know what I mean? Think about it. Telling children lies in the house of God is just as bad as the Catholic Church telling you to pray to Mary. Because Jesus said, if you cause a little one to stumble, it's better to put a milestone around your own neck and go throw yourself in the ocean than to cause a little one to stumble. Hey, I don't need a lot of kids to get the gospel out. How stupid is that? We got to use an Easter bunny with eggs. Bunnies don't even have eggs. Come on, man. Oh, my goodness. Well, we got to have a children's ministry, so we got to go let them hunt. You know, we want them to be relevant. No, we want them to be righteous.
Amen.
We want them to be disciples.
That's right.
We want them to follow Jesus, not the teachings of men, not the goosebumps. Let me tell you something. When you're out there in war for Jesus, those goosebumps won't hold you to the fire. It's going to be your relationship with God that's going to hold your feet in that foxhole when it all comes and down. Because let me tell you something. John the Baptist had a high calling on his life to point to the Lamb of God. But how did his life end? Let me tell you something. I came here today to preach on why Christians are hated, but as soon as I started and I sat down, the Holy Spirit turned it just a little bit. Said, no, preach against the prosperity message. I'm like, wow, because most people want to come to countries that are not so economically rich, and they want to bring you people the prosperity message. But I didn't know. The Holy Spirit is like, preach against it.
That's right.
Okay. So here's the deal. If you follow Jesus, you might get your head cut off.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
And that's not very popular. Matthew chapter 11. See, people in my country and other countries, they will teach you, come to Jesus and you're going to get blessed. If you'll just come up and give an offering. Now, there is sowing and reaping. God will bless. Hey, I gave as a single mom. I've always been a giver. I believe in giving. And you're going to reap finances. If you sow an apple seed, you're going to reap an apple tree. So I'm not saying don't ever sow. No, it's good to sow and give into other people. It keeps you from being selfish all the time. Okay? It's good sometimes. The poor woman in the Bible, she gave a little bit of what she had. Okay? So there is a sowing and reaping principle. But I'm talking about when you are a Christian, just because you are the cousin of Jesus doesn't mean you're going to live in luxury.
That's right. Yeah.
John the Baptist testified of the light of the world according to the scriptures in John 1. And then you see here 11:11. You know why I can remember 11:11, Pastor? You know why it's easy to remember? I'll tell you why. Because Jesus had 12 disciples and one of them was a devil. So it left 11. Think about that. 11:11. Wow. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom is greater than he. Okay? But let me tell you something, people. John the Baptist was sitting in jail when Jesus made that comment about his cousin. And he got his head chopped off. He was in ministry for 6 months. Linda Ravenhill did a sermon on John the Baptist. It was pretty good. A true prophet will be hated while they are alive and remembered after they're dead. Remembered after they're dead. Wow. James chapter 2. James 2, verse 5. Hearken, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised them to love him? Background on John the Baptist. He was going to be groomed to be like a priest and have it all. But he ended up in the wilderness waiting for his time of when God turns the light switch on. Years ago, I was walking across the Bible school parking lot, and I had an open vision from the Lord. And in the vision, a huge crowd was around me. And I was like, oh no, like I knew in my heart I didn't want to touch God's glory. And I thought, well, how did I get the crowd? And God was walking me through this, giving me revelation. So I looked up and I saw Jesus on his throne, because that's where he is. We serve a risen king. So Jesus is on his throne with a crown, fire in his eyes, and Jesus is looking down at the whole world. And I looked up to Jesus because there was a crowd looking at me. And he's like speaking to me, Angela, I want them. I want them. Because Jesus shed his blood for lost souls. So what God was saying to me is, I'm going to make you a lighthouse. There are going to be crowds around you. And when you have that crowd around you, do like this. Behold the Lamb of God.
Amen.
That takes away the sins of the world.
Amen.
See, John was saying, I'm not the light of the world.
Amen.
I bear witness of the light of the world.
That's
right. Yeah. So the most powerful calling on John the Baptist's life was when he saw Yeshua, Jesus Christ, walking. And he said, there he is. Now get your eyes off of me. Now get your eyes on the perfect, spotless Lamb of God.
Amen.
Wow. And he accomplished what he was born for. People say, I don't know what God's called me to do. I can tell you what God's called you to do. Be thankful, follow Christ, give him all the glory, and go for souls.
Amen.
It's really not that complicated.
Right.
Now, as far as does God want me to close my business, open a business, that's where your relationship with Christ is going to be a personal relationship with Christ. That's why we need to have a personal relationship with Christ, so we will know what he wants us to do personally. And for many years, I had my own cleaning business for 16 years. And I knew God was calling me someday to close it. And so I closed it, moved into my car, and moved to California. And my home in America is still a Honda. But I don't need a home. Think about it. I really don't. Do I need a home? No, because I'm traveling all the time. So it's not something to feel sorry for me about. I was very motivated by a John Wesley quote. John Wesley said, I look upon the whole world as my parish. That means the whole world is his church. It's kind of scriptural if you think about it, because Jesus is on his throne and he's looking at the whole world. Jesus loves the little children. All the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight.
Amen.
Jesus loves everybody. Everybody. The greatest in the kingdom are the children. So God wants us to have childlike faith. That's definitely the will of God.
That's right. Amen.
Childlike faith. To be like children. Daddy, where do you want me to go today? Abba, let's go to Taiwan. I've never been. Okay. Let's go. So God sends me to Taiwan. That's where I was before the Philippines. And in Taiwan, I'm like, okay, I don't have any connections. God, you bring the connections. And by the end of the trip, I'm like, wow, I've been preaching by myself and I don't have any connections. Okay, I guess this trip was about just me and you, God. That's okay, the gospel was preached. Many people heard. But just a few days before I left Taiwan, I was walking down a road. Have you ever just been walking and you felt like God was like, go this way and then take a left turn? And you're just walking because peace is leading you that way. You just gotta feel peace to go that way. Well, that's the Holy Spirit leading you. He wants to lead us with peace. And I ended up at a Christian coffee shop called Christ Aroma. And I started talking away. Wow, you guys are Christians? I was content with just seeing Christians in Taiwan, okay? But then God did something bigger than me just being excited about the Christians. There was a guy named Jay there. And I said, hey, Jay, I'm about to go preach the gospel. Do you want to go? I'll pay you. Because a lot of Christians aren't already trained to have the heart for evangelism like the Breitbarts are. Yeah. I know this. I've been in church 40 years. Only 6 years was I a prodigal. I hate to say that, but I'm a realist. Sometimes you got to pay the Christians to do something. Because they're not thinking about eternity. See? So I thought Jay would be the type that maybe he needed some extra money. He said, I don't want the money, I'll go with you. I said, really? Okay, awesome. So it made my eyes, I think, so much more highly of Taiwan because of one person. That's amazing. Because if there's a guy like Jay, there might be more people like Jay there. I just didn't meet them. So I try to be positive. I try. But it's hard sometimes because I travel the world and I rarely run into Christians sharing their faith. When it's clearly in the Word of God to go into all the world and preach the gospel, to share our faith. So it can be discouraging because I know God doesn't want us to just pray all the time. He wants us to pray and go. So Jay went with me and he was nervous. You know how it was your first time. He was nervous. He's like, I've never translated for anybody and I've never preached like this. But I tell you what, like by the third sermon we preached, he was lifting his arms when I lifted my arms. And he was getting really into it. Why? Because when you start preaching, it's like a valve of water. It's like you're turning on the valve. And the water flows. At first, the water might start bubbling out kind of slow. But once the water's flowing, it's like the river of life. And Jay was into it. And he was preaching. And I turned around to the people that were working in the shops. And I said, look, I need you to leave with a good memory. Okay? No, we didn't draw huge crowds. But I said, you need your first time as a good memory because the enemy will try to steal that seed from you and lie to you that it was a bad memory. I know this because I'm like a mom in the faith. So I, as a kind of a mom, I have to make sure that that seed is protected and it leaves a good lasting impression. So we turned around, we looked at the people staring at us. I said, did you hear us? They said, yes. I said, did you hear us? They said, yes. I said, Jay, they heard us. Even if it was just them that heard us, we shared the gospel. And I said, you people are now responsible. You're now responsible for what you've heard. So he went away and he was, you know how you are after you preach. You feel great. Well, why do you feel great? Because he was an answer to Jesus' desires. See, John the Beloved, not John the Baptist, but John the Beloved was the disciple that laid his head
his ear on the breast of Jesus. So he was listening. What's on your heart, Master? What's on your heart? Souls. Why? Because Jesus died on that cross to purchase. That's why this church has such a powerful name. Have you thought about it? The Blood Bought Church.
Amen.
See, you're bought with a price.
Amen. That's
why ain't nobody else gonna buy me.
Amen.
Ain't nobody else gonna buy me. I had somebody offer me $400 the other day when I came in Philippines. I'm gonna pay you back. But he started acting like he was gonna control me. I said, keep your money. Keep your money. God will bring in more money. I'm not going to let somebody buy me. And John the Baptist was a voice crying in the wilderness, eating locusts and honey, and he couldn't be bought. Well, thank God for those that are willing to just be rich in faith.
Amen.
And live for Jesus. Because I tell you one thing, you're going to be rewarded in heaven.
Amen.
For all eternity, and that's what's going to matter. It's going to matter on judgment day if Jesus says, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I don't need some fancy preacher to tell me well done. I want to hear it from Jesus Christ. Well done. And that's pretty much what I had to share. I wanted to say that Christians are hated because of John 3, where it talks about they hate you because they hate the light. Okay? They hate the light. So when you're shining, don't take it personal. They hate the Jesus in you. So they want... This is the thing about street preachers. You can't turn the light off. Because we're still screaming and screaming and screaming. Say that. Fine. Whatever. But the souls are out there. And we can keep screaming and screaming all the way to jail. Because when I was arrested in the Netherlands, I was preaching all the way while they had my hands behind the back. And when they put me in my jail cell, I preached to those police for 2 hours in the Netherlands. And then I started singing. And then the lady in charge of the Netherlands, there's two different cops there. She was in charge of the foreign police section. So they didn't know what the local police were saying. So it's two different. She said, can you please stop singing? We hear you. I said, good, I'm glad you hear me. You should have never arrested a preacher in the first place.
Amen.
Praise God. You might go to jail for Jesus. If you do, just keep singing. Amen.
Amen.
That's
amen.
All.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Are you blessed?
Amen.
Hello, Sister Angie.